Finally, I realized nothing was being done. My law, our law, has become a farce. I am against violence. I am anti-communist and anti-Castro. When my men occupy the land by force, I tell them to give it back, to wait. But how long will they wait? How long can they wait?
Vice President Nixon comes to Venezuela. How long can they wait? Until the small part of them that can still hope is enlarged. Things get worse, not better. From the first, Betancourt was unable to devote himself to his reforms. To stay in power, he had to make sacrifices. He had to rely increasingly on United States investments, on his own military, on the ruling interests. They oblige him to go slow. His program disintegrates. He comes to rely on those same men who had sustained Perez Jimenez. He cannot, or will not, create new centers of power based on the people. Betancourt moves steadily, ineluctably, to the right. Caracas, 16% unemployed. The government can do nothing. A terrible shortage of houses. The government can barely begin. The United States oil companies boom. Money does not come into these streets. Attacks against Betancourt intensified, and then even his own party split over his reactionary direction. The young go to form the movement of the revolutionary left, the MIR. Older men go into less radical opposition. Soon, Betancourt suppresses the Communist Party and the MIR. Here, it goes on. Where does it go? Where does it go? This street is quiet during the shutting down of opposition newspapers, the fury against students, the start of a terror worse than those before. Arrests go on around them. Their houses are searched. They do not remain apart. The government tries to crush the people who would change their lives. Meeting resistance, the government terror intensified. Agents from the Jimenez days ran the secret police, Digipol. Sotopol, an elite goon squad, roamed the streets. Venezuela was in a state of siege. Romulo, to the wall, the assassin. Opposition to the government was driven underground. The suppression tended to unite them. Terror made revolutionaries out of many who had hoped for peaceful change through the ballot. Reform from within the system was proving impossible. In 1962, after the uprisings of Carúpano and Puerto Cabello, the Armed Forces of National Liberation, the FALN, was formed to coordinate armed struggle. Comandante Elias Manuit of the FALN, Chief of Staff of the Guerrilla Front in Falcón.
By now, all who dream about elections should have realized that in this country, nothing is solved by elections. Because an individual who is not a revolutionary and obtains political power will not change the country's political, economic, and social situation. Just because this cannot be solved by a change of individuals, but simply by a change of systems. And the change of system cannot be brought about in this country except with the weapons in our hands.
Publications suppressed, leaders jailed, parties outlawed. What other alternatives remain for the people?
One of my sons identifies with leftist parties in spite of the beliefs, convictions, and traditions of the family. My son was taken prisoner during the recent revolt. He was held naked in a cell. To this was added primitive savage torture. He was submitted to head dunkings in water. And later, upon regaining consciousness, the procedure was repeated.
For the hunted activists, for the ordinary man, Betancourt's government was a military dictatorship. Resistance mounted in the city, in the backlands. Soon, the armed forces of national liberation chose to strengthen rural guerrilla fronts. They began to prepare for a long campaign. Actions continue in the city. The FALN guerrillas entrenched themselves. This was the start. Before the birth of the FALN, political alternatives were polarized between the liberal democracy that Betancourt represented and the conservative Communist Party. Both were equally separated from the conditions and needs of the people of Venezuela. But Castro's Sierra Maestra campaign was an example of another way. There, a small band began to build an island, a new society within the unproductive body of a stagnant society. They defended it with arms. Contact was made with the people and the movement swelled. Their success, the accomplishments of the revolution, provided inspiration throughout Latin America. It revealed the limitations of many of the older leaders. In Venezuela, this kind of revolution is beginning. A new generation of revolutionaries make up the FALN. Students, army officers, workers, professors, peasants, a senator. Inexperienced, various, flexible. Now they are in close touch with the actual basis of life in their country. Their movement can grow and deepen and retain its relevance to the life around them. And this new life also changes them. At first, they sabotaged to call attention to the state of things in their country. They thought in terms of imminent insurrection. But they realized that victory was not that close. Now, they stress strategic rural action. Organizing continues in unions, factories, slums, within the army rank and file. But all aims at strengthening this armed struggle in the countryside. The FALN began to build itself into the countryside, to gradually increase its territories of operations. In Miranda State, in Falcon, in Lara, Portuguesa, and Trujillo, four separate fronts with extensive peasant support. Of these guerrillas, most had never known anything but city life, university life before. Their politics were limited by their experience. Peasants, the former military, sons of the wealthy, workers, all lived together. The gifts, the information, the differences mingle. The girl cleaning her submachine gun was a student. Comandante Olga's acts during the years of sabotage, her escape from prison, are famous. They begin to establish ways different from the society around them. The FALN grows. The society outside stiffens against all dissent. In 1964, there were 1,500 political prisoners in the government jails. They live and work in groups of four and five. The squads are arranged widely in concentric circles around the headquarters. They gain the confidence of the peasants. Without their cooperation and friendship, the guerrillas could not survive. They remain responsive to the peasants.
In Lara, for example, we represent sanitation, education, government. We have open schools. We are for the sick. We have formed civil institutions of power, which are, in fact, organs of government.
Venezuelan armies, led by members of the U.S. military mission in Caracas, have failed to dislodge the guerrillas. They have failed also in attempts to win the peasants' support.
The government approached the peasants in the same way the Spaniards approached the Indians, with trinkets and necklaces, exchanging those things for iron, for petroleum, for everything we have. At first, the peasants are surprised. They wonder about all this sudden love. But then they finally realized that all the love came to them because of the guerrillas in the mountains. When we weren't there, well, nothing. Cavities rotted their teeth, they died of hunger, of malaria. Now they are given things. And they realize, because our peasant is intelligent, that the rulers are trying to drive the guerrilla movement out. On cold nights, we have smoked lucky strikes. We have eaten concentrated foods, and our women compañeras have even put all those funny trinkets. The peasant take those gifts and offer them to us and tell us what is happening. The enemy has realized that these methods fail. Now, instead of coming with a little present, they come in with a machete. They whip them. They torture them. As a matter of fact, one man in the presence of the rest of the inhabitants of the village was hung by his testicles to instill fear in all the people of the village. And then, after torturing him savagely, they tried to use him as a guide, and that peasant, knowing full well where we were, led them elsewhere. Not even by force could they use him. All the methods have failed them. All those methods they have brought from Vietnam have failed them.
It is rare for a hard-pressed peasant to be generous with his food. Once, the guerrillas stopped a truck that was passing through the village. They told the peasants to unload the truck and to take the food, and to keep it. Then they sent the truck away. They gather wild rice before returning to the camp. Now, after 2 years, they are largely self-sufficient. They live off the land. The peasants supply them with much. They draw together, a band of brothers, knitted together by their common opposition, their sense of what they are working toward, by the way of life they now share. They have begun to hammer out a new set of relations among themselves. They have begun in many ways. In the face of total repression, the FALN has shown a remarkable ability to sustain itself. The FALN is organizing patiently. It is prepared for a long struggle. Its roots have already gone down deep. And again, Manuit.
Therefore, I admire then the decision of all those revolutionaries who are starting their liberation. I respect the opinion of some leaders of some countries who are trying to gain power by pacific means. I respect their opinion. But at the same time, and you'll excuse me, I am obliged to say that they will not be able to stabilize themselves in power by those means.
The armed forces of national liberation assume that as they draw close to victory, the United States will send troops against them to defend American interests. We have interests elsewhere in Latin America, and elsewhere there are revolutionary movements. Hugo Blanco in Peru, Jan Sosa in Guatemala, others in Colombia. Will we intervene everywhere? Our present policies suggest that we will.